Hey guys, this is Cheyenne and this is my second video about centroids. As I told you earlier, I will talk about additional informations about centroid and I will tell you a very, very interesting proof for centroid at the end of this video. In the previous video, I told you what centroid is. Now I will give you another definition about centroid and I will also say that why these two definitions are equivalent. I will tell you that in a tree we will have at most two centroids and most of the time we only have one centroid in a tree. Also, I will tell you two other proofs in the end of this video. So let's first start talking about how many centroids does a tree have. Well, first of all, I want to just say that it's not possible to have two centroids which are not adjacent. So all the centroids, I want to say that all the centroids are adjacent. So I prove that by contradiction. Assume that we have two centroids and they are not adjacent. Well, then I can say that if I consider the path between these two vertices, there is at least one vertex in this path. Because if there wasn't any vertex, then these two vertices were adjacent. So if I consider this path, I know that the number of vertices in here is at most n half. Right. Why? Because this vertex is a centroid, and if I remove it, this connected component will have at most n half vertices. Therefore, the number of vertices in here is greater than or equal to n half. All the vertices except this part is greater than or equal to n half. Therefore, by the same approach, I can argue that the number of vertices in here is greater than or equal to n half as well. Why? Because the number of vertices in here is less than or equal to n half. So now I can say that I have at least n half vertices in here and I have at least n half vertices in here. Therefore, I have n vertices in these two components. But this is a contradiction because there is at least one vertex outside of these two components as well. And if we sum these values up, we have at least n plus 1 vertices, but we had n vertices. Therefore, it is not possible. And all the centroids should be adjacent. Okay, now that we know that all the centroids should be adjacent, it's easy to say that we cannot have three centroids. Because if we have three centroids, it's not possible that all of them have edges to each other. Otherwise, we had a triangle. We had a cycle of length 3. So it's not possible. So we have at most two centroids. And if we have two centroids, then these two centroids should be adjacent. They should have an edge to each other. This is the only way. And let's see how exactly that works. We know that one case is that we have one centroid, and we know that we always have at least one centroid. Because we prove that it always exists, we can always find the centroid. Therefore, it always exists. So we always have at least one centroid. So this is the case that we have one centroid. And it's also possible to have two centroids. And it works like this. We have two vertices, they are adjacent, and the number of vertices in here and in here should be both n half. Because we know that all the vertices are to the left of this edge or to the right of this edge. So the sum of them is n. If we want both of these vertices to be centroid, both of them should be exactly n half. If one of them is greater than n half, for example, this part is greater than n half, then this vertex is not centroid. Therefore, both of them are exactly n half. So this is the only case that we have more than one centroid. That we have two vertices and an edge between them. And these two connected components will have exactly and a half vertices. So now that we know how many centroids we have in a tree, we can discuss about the other definition of centroid as well. The other definition of centroid is this. Centroid, yeah, let's define this. Let's define S of V as the sum of the distances of all the vertices from vertex V. The sum of distances of all the vertices from vertex V. Okay. So I want to say that V is a centroid if and only if S of V is minimal. So I want to say that a vertex is a centroid if and only if the sum of this vertex to all the vertices is minimal. But why is that true? Why this definition is equivalent to the previous definition that we said earlier? Okay, so now I want to say that why these two definitions are equivalent. So the first definition was that a vertex, that if you remove it from your tree, all the remaining connected components will have at most n half vertices. The second definition is a vertex that the sum of its distances to all the other vertices is minimal. So the first thing I want to say that the definition one, the definition two gives you the definition one. It means that if for a vertex SV, S of V is minimal, then if you remove V from your tree, all the remaining connected components will have at most n half vertices. Okay, so assume that S of V is minimal. And let's prove by contradiction. Assume that we have a connected component that it has more than n half vertices. Then I want to say that for this vertex U, S of U is less than S of V. And this is a contradiction because we said S of V is minimal. Why is that true? Well, I say that if you compare U and V, U is closer to all these vertices. The distance from U to all these vertices is equal to distance from V to those vertices minus 1. So if you have a vertex A in here, D of V and A minus 1 is equal to D of U and A. And if we have a vertex outside of this connected component in here, then we can say that D of V and B plus 1 is equal to D of U and B. Okay, so I can say that S of U will be equal to S of V minus the number of vertices in here. For example, assume that this is the number of them is X and the number of vertices in here is Y. And Y is equal to N minus X. So I want to say that S of U is equal to S of V minus X, because for all of these X vertices, U is closer to them by one edge. And plus Y, because U is compared to V, V is closer to those vertices than U. So we should say plus Y. And since we know that Y is less than X, we can say that this number is negative. It's less than 0. If we say minus X plus Y is less than 0. Okay, this whole thing. So I can say that this value is less than S of V. Okay, because we can say that this part is negative. Therefore, S of U is less than S of V, and this is a contradiction. So if for a vertex, I know that the sum of the distances from all the vertices is minimal, then this vertex is a centroid. This vertex will have, if you remove it from your tree, all the remaining connected components will have at most n half vertices. So now let's assume that we have definition one for some vertex, and we want to reach definition two. So for a vertex, we now assume that we know that all the remaining components will have at most n half vertices. And we want to say that the sum of the distances from this vertex to all those all the other vertices is minimal. How do we say that? Well, there are two cases. The first case is that we have one centroid. Well, if you have one centroid, it's obvious. Because we know that the vertex that has the minimal S of V was a centroid. And for sure, that was this vertex. You know, in the previous page, we said that if a vertex, for a vertex, S of V is minimal, then it is the centroid. And if you have only one centroid, then that is the vertex with minimal S of V. Okay, it's just enough to say that let's find the vertex with the minimal S of V. For sure, that will be this vertex. Because we said that that vertex is a centroid and we have only one centroid. So that is this vertex. So this vertex has the minimal S of V. So it is obvious if we have minimal, we have only one centroid, then we can say that the vertex with minimal S of V will be that centroid. What if we have two centroids? If we have two centroids, as I said earlier, we know that in these two parts we have exactly n half vertices. And if we find the vertex with the minimal value of S of V, we know that it is one of these two vertices because we know that that is a centroid. Now I want to show that the other vertex will have the same value of S as this vertex. Let's call this one V and this one U. I want to say that S of U is equal to S of V. And therefore I can show that for this vertex also S of V is minimal. So I showed that previously that if for some vertex S of V is minimal, then that is centroid. Now I'm showing that if a vertex is a centroid, then S of that vertex is minimal. If I show that S of U is equal to S of V, then I'm done. And why is that? Then again, I can say that there are X vertices in here and Y vertices in here, and X and Y are equal. Both of them are n half. So I can say that S of U is equal to S of V minus y, because for all these y vertices in here, u is closer to them by one edge compared to v, and plus x, because for all the vertices in here, v is closer than u to them by one edge. And since these two values x and y are equal, this is 0 and this is equal to s of v, and therefore these two values are equal. Therefore, any vertex that is a centroid has the minimal value of S of V. And any vertex which has a minimal value of S of V is a centroid. So this can be another definition for centroid. And this also gives us another proof for centroid as well. Why? We showed that if we have minimal value of S, then that vertex is a centroid. So it's just enough to find the minimal value of S. We know that each vertex has a value of S, so one of them is minimal, that is a centroid. So this proves that a centroid always exists. So it's just enough to say that we can find, if we want to find the centroid and not only prove, proving that is done because we know that one of them has the minimal value of S and that is centroid. But now if we want to find it, we can just use dynamic programming to find the values of S easily. We can just find it for one vertex for the root, and for that root it is the sum of the heights of the vertices. So we find the answer for the root, and then after that we can just after that we find this value for the root. If we know the value for the parent of each vertex, we can find the value of S for that vertex itself as well. So if this is vertex V and this is vertex P, and we know S of P, then we can easily find S of V as well. S of V will be equal to S of P minus the size of the subtree of vertex V plus the size of plus n minus size of the subtree of vertex V. Because for all the vertices in here, it is closer to them by one edge, and for all the vertices in here, outside of this subtree, it is farther than p by one edge. So this way we can find all the values of s, and we can show that the one with the minimal value of s, and say that this vertex is a centroid. And there's also another beautiful proof for centroids. Well, it's just enough to say that for each edge, you can direct it to the connected component with the more number of vertices. So if for each edge you say that, for example, there are x vertices in here and y vertices in here, and assume that y is greater than or equal to x. So if they were equal, choose one side randomly. And if they were not equal, then choose the one with the greater size. So for each edge, we direct the edge to the connected component with more vertices. Then I can say that I have a graph with n vertices and n minus 1 edges. All right. And all of them are directed. So I can say that there will be one vertex with outgoing degree 0. Okay, if we have n minus 1 edges and n vertices, then at least one vertex will have outgoing degree 0. Because if all of them had outgoing edges, then we had at least n edges, because we have n vertices. If any of them had at least one outgoing edge, then we needed to have n edges. But we do not have that. Therefore, there will be at least one vertex with outgoing degree 0. And if we consider that vertex, for example, if it is vertex V, all of the edges go inside of V. So we are sure that all these connected components have less size compared to the connected component on the other side of this edge. So all of them will have at most n half vertices. So this is another proof that shows that a centroid always exists. And this way we can also find the centroid. We can just direct all the edges, and this way we will find the vertex with the outgoing degree 0 and say that this vertex is our centroid. Okay, so I'm done with the second video about centroids. If you had any question about any part of it, please tell me. And as I said in my previous video, I want to make as much as videos as possible that helps you. And please tell me if there is any specific topic that you want me to talk about that sooner than the other topics. And if you wanted me to continue this work and wanted to support me, you can like this video and subscribe to my channel. Thank you very much.